This is basically how far you have to take your ET5 apart to replace a piston O-ring. This engine is not as easy to work on as some of the hit and miss engines. And the main problem here is you have to take the engine loose from the base so that you can get to the screws that hold the exhaust pipe to the bottom of this head. If this exhaust pipe was not there, then you'd be able to remove the four head bolts, take off this back cover plate, and reach in and take the bottom end off the connecting rod. But because this is in the way, first you have to take the engine is mounted onto this base, so you have to reach in, take these long screws loose, release the base, then these screws come in from the bottom and attach this to the engine block. Then you can remove the exhaust pipe. Then you can get to the four head bolts, take the head off, take the rear cover plate off, reach in here with a 1.5 millimeter Allen wrench and loosen these up and push the piston out. Then it's just a matter of taking this ring off, put a new one on, put a little oil around it, and do all of that backwards so you can put it back together again. I take the flywheels off because it's a lot easier and a lot lighter to work on. All of this is made from solid brass. This is quite nice machining, actually. And this is all solid brass. I was kind of surprised that this was not open on the bottom. I thought it might be. And this is your head gasket. It's a piece of copper. It's very soft, so you want to be very careful with that. You need a 1.5, a 2, and a 2.5 millimeter Allen wrench. The ball end is handy. You need a regular end if you're tightening up things like the head bolts. And these are your two push rods that just push in here and come up and work these two valves. When the head comes off, those come loose. You don't have to mess with the valves or the rockers or anything. So from that standpoint, it's kind of handy. There's only a couple of things that can keep this from running. If you don't have enough compression, it's time to replace this O-ring. If you don't have a spark, the battery may be dead enough to where it's not putting out enough voltage to run this. One of these long bolts comes through and connects to this nut, and that is your ground connection. So if you're not getting a good ground connection, that could keep it from running. If you let the fuel tank go dry, or if it hasn't been filled, if there's even a hint of a bubble in this fuel line, this will not start. And the carburetor has to be in the fully closed position for this to start. And that's about it. Another reason for taking this all apart is these wires are all fairly small and delicate. And the base on this is machined so that Hall effect sensor just sits in there. And the screws come up through there and go into the bottom of the engine block. So it's a lot easier just to take this apart so you don't damage any of the wiring. You can unscrew the needle valve, loosen this nut up a little bit so this piece can move, unscrew this from the tank, and inside here are some very small, delicate O-rings. You can see one trying to come out of there now. So you want to keep track of those, and you don't need to hog down on these, tighten them up. You just need to be tight enough for this not to suck any air or leak. And again, you need to get all of the air out of this when you put fuel in the tank before this thing will run. And the exhaust has a small high temperature O-ring on the exhaust pipe flange. I marked the top of the connecting rod and the bottom end with a little black mark, so I put them together in the same orientation. And I marked this as being the top of the piston. When you're working on this, you might make sure that that wrist pin doesn't accidentally fall out on you and hit the floor. And I don't really know if this O-ring is bad or not, but it's coming out and being replaced. I just reach in here gently with a dental pick and just walk that out of there. And throw that away so you don't get it mixed up with the new ones. The head and the valves and everything are very clean. No signs of carbon. and there was no carbon on top of the piston. So my mixture of Coleman lantern fuel and Marvel mystery oil seemed to be very clean burning. A lot of these fasteners are quite small. You may have difficulty finding a replacement if you lose one. Most of the time, I'll just screw them back in where they came from, or leave them sticking in the head, or put them in a small pill bottle and then put the lid on it, and then you can find them again. I take the lower end off of the connecting rod, put a little oil around here, put a new piston ring on there, and then push this back in there gently with oil on it.
Now you engage the connecting rod with the crank pin and push up on the piston until the crankshaft rotates to bottom dead center.
And then gently reach in there and reinstall the end on the connecting rod. That's a little tedious, but you can do it. But I'm not going to do it on camera. Actually, it wasn't too hard. You can reach up in there with your little finger and hold up on that piston, or reach in there with the end of a small wrench and push it up,
and continue to hold the connecting rod against the crank pin.
I took the lower end of the con rod, picked it up with a small needle nose, and just dropped it down on top of there, and you reach in with a wrench. These are fine threads. I have a video where I talk about timing the threads. When you go in there, turn it backwards until you feel it click and you know that thread is timed and ready to engage. Then screw it in. If you do it that way, you're not likely to cross thread or strip the threads out. When you're putting these socket head screws in here to hold the base onto the crankcase, they only engage in threads about 1.5 or 2 turns. So don't try to over-tighten those, you'll strip them out.
Reassembly of the engine took about 15 minutes. With the bolt sticking up, I put a washer over the bolt, and then this ground connection, and then tighten the nut on top of that. That should have a good ground. This particular engine only has one battery for a power supply. So I have checked it, and it has good voltage. Turn the lights out. So that's good spark. There is no mechanical connection between the plug and the spark plug. This boot pushes onto the plug. This wire is just cut off flush and it pushes up until it just touches the end of the plug. And that's good enough. The head bolts were too long and were nearly bottoming out in the threaded holes in the block. So I shortened those by 2 or 3 millimeters. If the head bolts bottom out, then the head will not be able to compress against the head gasket. That would be another reason for not having compression.